Welcome to the third WPF Basics tutorial. Part 1 introduced you to the markup language. The second part taught you binding. In this tutorial, you will easily learn a feature often used with binding – value converters. We are going to start by looking at common situations where value converters are often used. Then we are going to quickly learn how to make our own value converter. Finally, I'm going to create more converters to show you how simple it is to make and use them. I've made a demonstration project where you will see three different converters. In our main window there are three properties, one for each example. In the constructor I've set DataContext to this main window, so now all three properties are visible in XAML and can be bound from it. The first converter takes in a boolean value and returns the opposite value. This is a very common example because the view has lower priority than the logic, so instead of changing the logic to fit the view, we created a converter which makes an inverse value. In the second example, we convert boolean to integer. So if the value is false, we return 2, but if the value is true, we return 5. In the last example, you see a boolean to visibility converter. If the value is true, the visibility is set to visible. But if the value is false, we set it to hidden. Alternatively, I could have set it to collapsed if the boolean is false. As for other common uses of converter, I first of all can think of a button being enabled or disabled, based on whether a text box has some text or does not. Secondly, there are converters that check whether an int value is greater than some number and return true if it is, or false if it isn't. Also, it is typical for a converter to take in a string value, check if it contains specific text, and return true or false. Well, why do we waste time speaking of examples? So let's make our first value converter. Start by creating a new class. The name of each converter conventionally ends with the word converter. Then derive it from iValueConverter interface. Press Ctrl dot and include using system Windows data. Press Ctrl dot again and select Implement interface. After that we have two methods, convert and ConvertBack. Most converters are only one way, so ConvertBack is rarely used. The most basic converter works only with the value. By default, both methods will throw not implemented exception if you try to use a converter one way or another. They both return a converted value when called. We will start with the convert method that will work only with the value. The value taken in is of object type, so before we return it, we need to cast it to bool. And to invert the value, just put the exclamation mark before casting. Now we need to define our newly created converter in window resources. Be sure that you put the local prefix before the converter's name. The most important is to give it a key. I usually just copy the converter's name and make the first character lowercase. Then you should build your project, because right now XAML is not fully aware of its presence in the namespace. Go into code behind and create a public property that we will bind to from XAML. Don't forget that you need a property for binding, not a field. Also set the data context to this window, and we will be able to work with its C# properties in XAML. I've already made a text block where text is bound to the property, so that we always see its value. But we will use a converter in binding of a buttons is enabled property. Let's see how it works without a converter. I will set the property license expired to false. When we run our program, the isEnabled property of a button is the same as the license expired property. In real world, it is wrong because the license hasn't expired yet, but the button is already disabled. And that's where we need a converter. Set bindings converter property in curly braces and reference our converter as a static resource by the key name that we gave it. Now, when license expired is set to false, the isEnabled property has the opposite value. Now let's learn how to use the ConvertBack method. We will need another converter. I will just duplicate the existing one and rename the copy. I will name it boolean to int converter. Its convert method will take in a boolean value and return 5 if it's true, or 2 if it's false. The ConvertBack method will take in an int value, check if it's less than 5. If it is, the converter will return false. If it is 5 or greater than 5, the converter will return true. I will create another bool property for this demonstration. Again, define the new converter as a static resource in XAML. I have a text block with its text bound to the border thickness property of a border, so we can see border thickness value. We will use our converter on borders border thickness binding. When the C# property is false, the converter returns true. If we set it to true, the border will have border thickness equal to 5. We have just used the convert method of the converter just as before. Now let's create another property to see how ConvertBack can be used. When we used the convert method, we bound dependency properties to C# properties. Using the ConvertBack method, now you need to use binding on a property, the value of which you will pass to a converter. The C# property will be set based on the dependency property of a visual control. In order to explain that you need to call the ConvertBack method, you need to set mode to one-way to source. Let's create a text block and bind its text to the bool property, so that we see its value. Most of the time, target type can be fully ignored. In theory, you can make your converter very universal by defining multiple conversions depending on the target type. But converters are typically created for specific types. Parameter is optional and can be used when you want to, say, make a universal or conditional converter. For example, you have a converter that takes in an int value, like a school grade, from 0 to 100. The converter will convert int to a string saying passed if the grade is equal to or greater than the threshold, or failed if the grade is below it. The parameter in this example can be used to set the threshold directly in XAML instead of C#. If you don't use a parameter, you will need to create a new converter for each new threshold, and that is stupid. Don't be stupid, reuse your code. I will create an int public property called grade for this demonstration. Let's set it to 50 for now. As always, create a static resource for this converter, give it a lowercase key, and rebuild the project. Then bind the text property of textBlock to the grade property and set the needed converter. But this time you should also specify a converter parameter for binding. Let's try 45. So a converter takes in a value of some type and returns a converted value of the same or another type, depending on how you define it. Just to show you how trivial this is, I'm going to create another value converter that takes in another value type. Simple, right? I asked you a question, no response? Okay, not everyone is educated. To sum up, value converters are used almost as often as binding, and often used with it to take a value of some type and return a value of another type. Converters can take in a parameter for the sake of reusability. Converters are easy to create and use. Another example for you. I will create a converter that checks if string is empty. If it is empty, the converter will return false, otherwise true. I hope by now you remember the procedure. You create a class and derive it from iValueConverter or duplicate another converter. Then you code the conversion, making use, if needed, of the parameter and target type. After that, you create a static resource in your resources and give it a key, preferably starting with a lowercase. Then you rebuild your project. And finally, you can use your converter, referencing it by key in binding. That's it. In this tutorial, we have taken a look at value converters, all of which are designed for taking in one value. For multiple values, there are multi-value converters, but that's for another tutorial. So subscribe and we'll forget about your little fiasco with ignoring my question.